Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Today is the mark of the church, sign of God, part 3. Shabbat Shalom. And this is the conclusion of this series, which we have started, and we've unpacked some very dynamic, interesting, powerful things. And I believe that today will be no different. So we are going to, as I said previously, we're going to put some of these historical facts on trial, and some of the people on trial, and we're going to establish truth here today. So with that being said, there isn't any announcements, because we do have a lot of teaching to go through. We're going to get straight into prayer, so we can begin. Father in heaven, we are thankful for this day. This is a day that you established, made, set aside, sanctified, and blessed. And we know that today is one of your feasts, one of your holy days. So it's our prayer, Father, that you will be in the midst of this assembly today, that we don't come and go out of vain repetition, but come to please you, to worship you and serve you in accordance to the way you desire to be worshipped and served. Father, we pray that you'll speak to us today, that there will be words of knowledge spoken during the teaching and fellowship, words of wisdom, prophecy, and may all the manifestations of your Spirit flow freely amongst us. Let there be no hindrance in this place for your presence to move. And if there is, Father, we ask that you will reveal it to us. If there be anything in me or any one of the brethren, we pray that you will instruct us in the ways in which we can come before you without spot, without blemish, holy and righteous, ambassadors of your holy and righteous kingdom, which is first within and which is also to come. We pray in Yeshua's name that you will use our ministry, use us, and use this teaching to bring edification, to bring knowledge, wisdom, and understanding to the body of Messiah and to those who have an ear to hear. We ask that your will is done today, that your name is glorified today, and that your kingdom comes in this place. Now be glorified today. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So, over the last few teachings, what we've really been looking at is the mark of the church, the sign of Jehovah, and the sign that Yeshua gave to an evil and adulterous generation. And what we have been able to establish is that we are quite clear in the understanding that Yeshua gave the people a sign in which they were to know that he was the one who would lead them back to a place of reconciliation. But what we found is that the people did not give heed to the sign, and as a result, we're going to see what took place after Yeshua's ascension. So let's begin. So in a bid to reconcile the evil and adulterous generation back to Jehovah, Yeshua offers himself and his time spent in the heart of the earth 3 days and 3 nights as a sign. And we see that, and that draws upon the correlation between Jonah being in the belly of the whale and being a sign unto the Ninevites. Furthermore, warning his disciples about the deception, the intentional leading away from the truth of many, Yeshua teaches his disciples not to follow the false Christs and false prophets that shall arise. Yeshua continues to warn his disciples that as a consequence of ignoring the signs and giving heed to the false Christs and false prophets, the many who are led astray, the deceived will persecute the few. So there are these people who, according to Yeshua, are going to be deceived by false Christs, false anointed ones, and false prophets, these false declarers of the word. What that will essentially result in, as we're going to see, is the persecution of the few who lay hold of the truth and are not part of that group who are being led astray. And we can draw that from Matthew 24. Now, there's a situation that takes place when the people, his disciples, after he's lambasted the Pharisees, are talking about how beautiful the temple is. Look at the buildings of the temple. So Yeshua essentially tells them that these things, it's coming down. Not one stone shall be laid upon another. And then in verse 3, and as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming? So the context is particularly about when the destruction of the temple shall be, what will be the sign of thy coming, and the end of the world, or the end of the age. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Now, what's interesting about what he's saying is that one of the things which year after year people get continually hoodwinked about is the signs of his coming, the end of the world. People are always, year after year, there's a new date, there's a new prophecy, there's a new book, and so on and so on. But he says, take heed that no man deceive you. In other words, I'm going to tell you these things, and you are to listen to what I'm saying. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginnings of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted. Now this is the they, which is being spoken about, is the people who are the deceived and the deceivers. Because he's saying, then shall they deliver you. The you is the people, his disciples, who hold on to the truth. So there's a deception of many which is taking place. And those who are the deceived and the false Christs and the false prophets shall deliver those who hold the truth, the disciples of Yeshua, to be afflicted. And this affliction here is phlipsis, which is 2347. And it's important to look at the definition because we'll see. A pressing together, pressure, internal pressure, persecution, affliction, distress, and tribulation. This is what this affliction is talking about. And shall kill you. So then they shall deliver you up to be afflicted, to feel pressure, to go through tribulation, internal pressure, and shall kill you. And ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, scandalizo, which is 46:24. And this word, scandalizo, or offended, is to cause to stumble, cause to sin, cause to become indignant, shocked, offended. So Yeshua here is, and it's very easy to read past it and to read through what he's saying. But the scenario that Yeshua is describing is that there will be false teachers who come, who will lead many to be deceived, and they and the deceived ones will cause you to be afflicted, to feel pressure, to feel persecuted, to feel a tribulation. And because of that persecution, there will be many who will be caused to stumble, to fall short, to be brought into sin. This is again important to understand because again we are talking about the mark of the church and the sign of Jehovah. And shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And again, many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity, anomia, the condition of without law, shall abound, and that's to increase, to multiply, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure until the end, the same shall be saved. And in verse 14, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Now we've heard many sermons, many teachings, many gospel accounts, but it doesn't necessarily portray the gospel as being directly connected to the truth, and as a result of people being deceived, iniquity, lawlessness abounds to the degree that the gospel as it is presented today, which we're going to see is part of this deception, actually does away with the obedience of the gospel, which is causing the iniquity to abound. That they who shall deliver you up to be afflicted and killed because you are hated, at the beginning of sorrows are those who are deceived and the deceivers of the many, the false Christs and false prophets. Now this is taken from John 16 verse 2. They shall put you out of the synagogues. The time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. Now this is talking about a situation where the disciples of Yeshua predominantly, because we're talking about a first century church, as it was written, were being persecuted, not by any Gentiles. That did come, but by the religious leaders of the time. That's why where we see Paul himself receiving letters and going around trying to capture these people, putting them in prison and so on and so forth. But he's saying there's a time which is to come. And we're going to look at that time. According to Yeshua, the false Christs and prophets who are responsible for the deception of many will cause the few to feel afflicted, pressure, persecution, distress and tribulation. This affliction, which will lead some to death, will cause many of the few to be offended. So you have many who are deceived. You have a few who hold on to the truth. And out of that few who hold on to the truth, many of them will be caused to stumble. And it is because of iniquity, lawlessness that abounds, that the love of many shall wax cold. Now this is a passage from Daniel 7, which I think ties in very neatly to what we are discussing right now. And he's talking about the beast kingdoms, the beasts, the kingdoms that shall arise. And in this scenario, we know he's talking about the Roman kingdom. He's obviously writing at a time where he's part of that Babylonian Persian kingdom. And he's speaking prophetically about what shall arise after. And what he says is, and he shall speak great words against the Most High. This is that Roman kingdom. And shall wear out the saints of the Most High and think to change times and laws. Daniel 7 verse 25. And we're going to look at that in a bit more depth as we move on. Yet, he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. So even though there is this filtering which is taking place between those who have the truth and those who have the truth and overcome the stumbling blocks, the offenses, the causes to sin, it's those who endure until the end, holding on to that truth, they are the ones that shall be saved. This illustration of the beginning of sorrows after the ascension of Yeshua provides insight across the ages of how the many, the deceived, afflict the few, those who have the truth, which they are to endure in until the end of the age and the return of Yeshua. So even at the time when Yeshua said these things, he was speaking about a time which is to come, the beginning of sorrows, all the way up until we get to the tribulation when the Son of Man eventually returns and his people are gathered together. But when we head over to Revelation, which is again speaking about a time which is to come, that picture is essentially painted again. And it says in 12:17, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. These are those people, again, who hold on to truth or are called out of wherever they come from by the Spirit of Jehovah. They've been given truth, and as a result, the dragon, the enemy, that serpent, the devil, is wroth with them and goes to make war with them. This is what Yeshua is essentially talking about. But Yeshua paints that picture going through the ages. And we've seen that. Historically, we've seen it. And it's something which is mirrored to come. Revelation 20 verse 4. And here is to just double up on that. And I saw thrones and they sat upon them. And judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. So this is the pattern that was established by Yeshua. This is the way it's going to work. The few will be afflicted, pressed, oppressed, feel that pressure by the many who are deceived. And the driving influence of that deception is the false Christs, the false prophets who are hearing and obeying the devil. Amen. The persecution of those who hold the truth, the few, by those who are the many, the deceived, inspired by false Christs and prophets, lays the historical groundwork for us to understand how and why the transition of the Sabbath to Sunday initially took place. Furthermore, this understanding provides the ingredients to lay hold of how deception feeds into the affliction of the few because they hold the truth at present and in the years to come. In doing so, what we have been taught, both theology and history, will be placed on trial, so the parting of the ways of truth can be identified and restored. Hallelujah. And this is what is critical in this day and age. It's critical to scrutinize what we've been given. Because I remember being at school, and I remember being taught that when Jesus came, he established a religion called Christianity. That's what I was taught. And lo and behold, because I'm part of the system, that's what children are being taught today. However, when we scrutinize the historical books and the Bible, we see that actually not to be the case. So there's a deception which has taken place. And because of this deception, the people who call themselves believers in Jesus are acting like Christians and not acting like Yeshua. When we study the Bible, look at the Bible, Yeshua says something, and he says to the Samaritan woman, who essentially didn't know what she was doing or what she was talking about, she said, salvation is of the Jews. Now, what people hear when they hear that, I don't have a clue what they hear. But I know that historically, people have been saying that we need to flee from the ways which was preserved by Judean people, Jewish people, and move into a new understanding so we can be into this dispensation of grace. Let's just get straight into it. Now, here's a quote, and I'm not responsible for the quote, so there are some things which I have to, you know, which is in the quote, which I'm assuming, because we're schooled people, we know what it's saying. So Jewish Christians, also Hebrew Christians or Judeo-Christians, were the original members of the Jewish movement that later became Christianity. In the earliest stage, the community was made up of all those Jews who accepted Jesus as the venerable person or the Messiah Christ. As Christianity grew and evolved, Jewish Christians became only one strand of the early Christian community, characterized by combining the confession of Jesus as Christ with continued adherence to Jewish traditions such as Sabbath observation, observance of the Jewish calendar, observance of Jewish laws and customs, circumcision, and synagogue attendance, and by direct generic relation to the earliest Jewish Christians. Now, we're learned people, or I'm hoping we're learned people. So a lot of that is a quote, but we can decipher what the quote is saying. These customs, these traditions, many of the things that the disciples of Yeshua did, or should have been doing at the least, were not traditions for the Jews. It was the law of Jehovah. And the law of Jehovah was given to Israel. And consequently, when Messiah came, being an Israelite, an Hebrew, he fulfilled the law because he is the law which was established in the beginning. And we're going to see that it wasn't just for the Jews, because when Gentiles came in, let's just carry on. First century Jewish Christians were totally faithful religious Jews. They differed from other contemporary Jews only in their acceptance of Jesus as the Messiah. Those that taught that Gentile converts to Christianity ought to adopt more Jewish practices than the church had already included, however, were called Judaizers. That's what a term I've been called within the last few years, and I'm presuming the moment you start telling people about the Sabbath, you get called a Judaizer too. But this is something which goes all the way back to the inception of Yeshua's Messiah and the faith that was delivered to the saints. Though the Apostle Peter was initially sympathetic, the Apostle Paul opposed the teaching of the incident at Antioch. And again, we have to be learned people, and we've done teachings on this in the curse of the law. So this isn't my doctrine here or my teaching. This is a quote from Wikipedia. And at the Council of Jerusalem, where Paul's teaching was accepted by the whole church, nevertheless, and here's the ending, Judaizing continued for several centuries, particularly among Jewish Christians. That's just our opening summary or statement, if you would, before we move on into really establishing the historical text. Acts chapter 10, verse 1. Acts chapter 10, verse 1. There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Band, a devout man, and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. So, according to historical theologians, the conversion of the Gentiles roughly took place at 37 to 40 AD. And the Council of Jerusalem takes place roughly 48 to 50 AD. Without there being any command from Jehovah, Yeshua, or the apostles in the Bible, we can conclude with historical support at this first step in the chronology of events that took place after the ascension of Yeshua, that his followers still observed the Sabbath. Now, when you take a look at this, who this man actually was, in terms of him being devout and what that means, and fearing the Almighty with all of his household, we can conclude that this was a righteous man. But he might have been righteous without essentially fully understanding Yeshua and things of the Spirit, which is why Jehovah sent Peter to teach him some of those things. But at this point in time, and prior to this point in time, the salvation which was given unto the Jews, which manifested in Yeshua, did not include a moving away from the commandments, statutes, and judgments, because we do not see that in any of the Gospels or the book of Acts. So this is our first step. The next step, and these are things we're just giving a glimpse, and you can study and research and find out for yourself. The Didache. Has anyone heard of that before? Okay. The Greek for teaching is a much debated early Christian instruction manual. It's debated. It's perceived to be an early first century Christian instruction manual. At present, the canonical book is dated between 70 and 100 AD. And I'm giving you these dates because we're building a picture, with some arguing dates as late as 300 AD. The claim of historians is that the Didache is a work of the 12 apostles. Now, I'm not saying it's a work of the 12 apostles. I'm just saying it's a claim of a work of the 12 apostles, which has been dated at the end of the first century. It is argued that the Didache is a church manual for first century Christians. And this is what it says. It says, on the Lord's day of the Lord, come together, break bread and hold Eucharist, after confessing your transgressions, that your offering may be pure. And that is in chapter 14. Now, what generally takes place by people who might look at passages like this is, because there's been this process, and I've defined the term semantic change before, which is the redefinition of words and phrases, in the mind of the Christian, which comes later, is that this book, which is a late first century book, supposedly written by the apostles, is teaching that Sunday is the day when you come together. But when you look at what John wrote, roughly the same time period, this is what John says in chapter 1 of Revelation, verse 10. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. So what we have is, we have a historical document which is talking about coming together on the Lord's Day. And we have an apostle of Yeshua saying that he was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. Now the perception, if you don't go through the process that we've gone through in part one and part two, is that this Lord's Day is talking about Sunday. But that's simply not the case, because we established that Yeshua never rose on Sunday. He rose on the Sabbath. Furthermore, he ascended to the Father on the day of first fruits, being the first fruits of among the dead. So John, who would know, who got taught by Yeshua 40 days after he rose from the dead, would know these things. And that's going to be made clear very soon. So, despite attempts to associate the only verse in Scripture which uses the term the Lord's Day to Sunday, when it is used in Revelation, roughly written 95 to 96 AD, there is no evidence to support such a claim. There's no evidence to support such a claim, and this is the only place in the Bible where that term is used. As a result, the Didache, which also fails to produce evidence of a transition away from the Sabbath, which is written again between 70 and 100 AD, only shows evidence today of semantic change, a redefinition of words from people who came later. Now, an example of that, and we've looked at this before, would be the use of the term gay. Now, if William Shakespeare describes the fellow as a gay fellow, and you read that, you have to go into the mind of the time to understand what he's actually saying, as opposed to what we receive today. The same thing with dispensation. In the Bible, dispensation is talking about an office, an administration, a management of grace. Whereas today, when people hear dispensation, they think an age. And then as a result, because of the doctrine, they're thinking ages of grace instead of a ministry, an office, an administration of grace. Semantic change. And this is where essentially we can get this, the Lord's Day, from. If we're going to draw it from anywhere, let's draw it from Scripture. Matthew 12:8. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day. Mark 2:28. Therefore the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. Luke 6:5. And he said unto them, that the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. So Yeshua, the Son of Man, is Lord of the Sabbath. So if we're going to draw any conclusion about the Lord's Day is more than likely, according to what is being written by John, to be the Sabbath, because that's the day he's the Lord of. That's the only conclusion you can come up to if you are forcing yourself to come to a conclusion. The Apostle John, who wrote the only passage of Scripture regarding the Lord's Day, despite not recording when Yeshua said he is the Lord of the Sabbath, was present along with the rest of the disciples when he said it. So John is the only person in the Gospels who doesn't record it, but he was there, because it tells us that when they was walking through the field of corn, that he was with his disciples and they were hungry. So John was there. He is the one who wrote in Revelation that he was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. The Gospel of John and his epistles provide possibly the most overwhelming support for the observation of the Sabbath by the first century church, the called out few, as his writings are the latest in the timeline of New Testament books, estimated roughly 81 to 89 AD. So John, his gospel, his epistles, and the revelation of Yeshua Messiah is the latest in the timeline of the New Testament books. And yet it just so happens that people, for whatever reason, choose to circumnavigate what is written in those epistles and gospel and the revelation to go and choose something which is more convenient, connected to their religious bias. This is what he wrote. 1 John 2, verse 3. And hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. So we're going to find that there are some liars, false Christ, false prophets, false church fathers, who are not the fathers of the called out ones. They're fathers of some other group. But whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him, or himself also so to walk, even as he walked. Now the person that we're supposed to walk as he walked is Yeshua. The Bible teaches us that Yeshua went up to Jerusalem to observe the feasts, which is why he's saying to the Samaritan woman, you don't know what you worship, for salvation is of the Jews. He's telling that what we can see in the Gospels, that Yeshua is in the synagogue observing the Sabbath and teaching on the Sabbath. We're to walk as he walked, not as these other people that came in. And there's a reason why they came in and changed up the whole platform. And we're going to have a look at that in a moment. So the Gospel, Epistles, and Revelation of John the Apostle was written during a time of great affliction against the Jews, which included the followers of Messiah. That provides a manual on how to overcome offenses, causes to sin and stumble, which came during the time of their writings. If you know anything about the first century church, or anything about Israel and what happened, Jewish history, if you would, you will know that there was a season, and Yeshua alludes to this when he's talking about the beginning of sorrows, that the temple was completely destroyed. There was a persecution which came with that. Now, John is in the midst of that scenario. He's actually on an island. He's been banished, the island of Patmos, and he's writing the book of Revelation. But prior to that, he wrote the epistle of 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And in those epistles, he's telling the people, this is how you overcome the world. This is how you know that you are in him and he is in you. In 1st John 5, verse 1, whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begat loveth him also that is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? So despite what we've been taught, Jesus did not establish or come to begin a new religion called Christianity. That's simply not the case. because Christianity, a term recorded first by Ignatius in the 2nd century, 107 AD, is distinct from the disciples who were first called Christians in Antioch in the 1st century. Now you've got the emergence of another group. You have a group which are called Christians first, historically or recorded first, in 107 AD by Ignatius, who began drifting away from the Christians in the King James Bible, who were disciples. When you look at the book of Acts, the disciples kept the law. The reason why they kept the law is because their master Yeshua told them that the commandments, they are life, everlasting. They was there when the people was asking him, how do I get into the kingdom? So they know. But in the 2nd century, a new group arose. And here is possibly the key reason why this new group arose and separated from what Yeshua came to establish and the apostles. The Fiscus Judaicus was a tax imposed on the Jews by the Roman Emperor Vespasian in roughly 70 AD. Prior to the tax, the Jews had sent a half shekel annually to the Temple of Jerusalem. After the Roman destruction, they would be required to send the same amount to the Temple of Jupiter, Capitolinus, in Rome. The Roman historian, and I'm going to get all these names wrong, so just excuse me, Suetonius, tells us that Domitian, Emperor Vespasian's successor, so we have a tax which came in 70 AD, which is essentially, you need to say, we've just destroyed your temple. So all of that money, that tithe money that you used to send to the temple in Jerusalem, you're now going to send to Rome, and it's going to be at the Temple of Jupiter. That's what you're going to do. Now, the successor of that initial emperor imposed this tax with the utmost rigor, and that those were persecuted who, without publicly acknowledging that faith, yet lived as Jews, as well as those who concealed their origin and did not pay the tribute levied upon their people. Gentile Christians were also subject to this affliction. Cassius Dio reports that Domitian also executed Romans who had drifted into Jewish ways. These Jewish ways, according to Hemstra, included Christianity. Domitian's persecutions were so unpopular, so in 96 AD, his successor, Nerva, set about reforming the administration of the tax. So what we have here is a time period where there's a tax which is being imposed upon Gentile Christians, believers in Jesus, but essentially could be Roman citizens, because they are living as do the Jews. Sabbath observation, circumcision, keeping the law, keeping the feasts, because that's what they've been taught to do. However, there's a reform which takes place. The reform was to redefine Judaism as a religion. Cassius Dio, the Roman historian, states the fiscus Judaicus tax was imposed on Jews who continued to observe their ancestral customs. So no longer was it because you belonged to a race or because you belonged to this group, etc., etc. The imposing of the tax and the persecution is based upon if you continue to observe these customs and these laws and statutes and judgments of your ancestors. Christianity would now viewed by the Romans as not Judaism, no longer Judaism. The fiscus Judaicus applied to neither Gentile Christian nor Jewish Christians who did not continue to observe ancestral customs. So, what this is telling us, what history is telling us, is that there was a relief of the tax, there was a relief of the affliction if you identified yourself as being Christian. And the way you identify yourself as being Christian is no longer living as do the Jews. The way you no longer live as do the Jews is you set aside, you move away from the customs of the Jews. So John wrote about keeping the commands at roughly the same time the persecution relief was given to those who believed in Jesus but broke them. It's roughly the same time. This begins the beginning of sorrows where offenses, stumbling blocks, causes to sin laid by false Christs and prophets came, and the law of Jehovah, including the Sabbath, was abandoned by believers in Yeshua. If we have an established doctrine that we're to walk as Yeshua walked, then we look at him and we come to the place where we say, we have to do what he did. He's the word which was established in the beginning. He didn't come to destroy, but he came to fulfill. However, if every person, and if you look at this tax, if every person in your household has to give a tax, including your hand servants, your maid servants, any slaves that you have, because you observe the Sabbath. People who come in to, imagine it, you believe in Jesus, but you have to pay all this money. But now there's this new doctrine where I don't have to pay it. All I have to do is believe on the Lord's Day. All I have to do is believe on another day and I don't have to pay this kind of stuff. And this is one of the things that John said at the time when this tax was being pushed on the people. Revelation 22:14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. So, this is now we're beginning to look at this second century, and I told you we need to just hold on. This is going to be some good stuff. The epistle of Ignatius, the supposed disciple of Apostle John, to the Magnesians, dated early 100 AD. So early in the second century, we have this epistle, which was written by the supposed disciple of John, the apostle. So this apostle John, who is telling us in the book of Revelation that the blessed ones who will enter in are those who keep the commandments. The ones who know him are the ones who keep the commandments, and so on. This supposed disciple, according to church tradition, this is what he writes. Be not deceived with strange doctrines, nor with old fables, which are unprofitable. For if we still live according to the Jewish law, we acknowledge that we have not received grace. For the divinest prophets lived according to Christ Jesus. On this account also, they were persecuted, being inspired by his grace to fully convince the unbelieving that there is one God who has manifested himself by Jesus Christ his Son, who is his eternal word, and not proceeding forth from silence, and who is all things pleased him that sent him. If therefore those who were brought up in the ancient order of things have come to the possession of a new hope, no longer observing the Sabbath, but living in the accordance of the Lord's day. So this is a disciple, a supposed disciple of John, who never actually heard the things that John said. John was there. This is where you see this redefinition of this Lord's day. Because Yeshua says, I am the Lord of the Sabbath. On which also our life has sprung up again by him and by his death, whom some deny, but which mystery we have obtained faith. And I'll leave that there. That's chapters 8 and 9 in that epistle. According to Christian doctrine, Ignatius, the supposed disciple of Apostle John, is one of the bishops. This is one of those supposed bishops who took over this so-called popeship of Peter, of whom the apostles allegedly passed down the oral traditions distinct from the Bible. So when we go back into this doctrine, there are these people who handed down some traditions which are distinct from the Bible, and he was one of them, and it's quoted in the texts. He's one of these people. But yet, when you meet people, they don't know this stuff. What they believe is that this stuff is in the Bible. They will look at the Bible and say, this is where it says we don't need to keep Sabbath. But the reality is, it doesn't say that. Paul doesn't say that. Peter doesn't say that. John doesn't say it. Yeshua doesn't say it. But it comes from these people who came after and then gave a twisted interpretation of what is said. And that's what's being quoted today. And this is where he's being quoted from. Sunday is expressly distinct from the Sabbath, which it follows chronologically every week. For Christians, its ceremonial observance replaces that of the Sabbath. In Christ's Passover, Sunday fulfills the spiritual truth of the Jewish Sabbath and announces man's eternal rest in God. For worship under the law prepared for the mystery of Christ, and what was done there prefigured some of the apostles. And to justify that teaching, here is Ignatius's quote. Those who lived according to the old order of things have come to a new hope, no longer keeping the Sabbath, but the Lord's day, in which our life is blessed by him and by his death. And that's page 470 on the Catechism of the Catholic Church. So these are some of the supposed traditions which are being handed down by the disciples of the apostles, and yet these disciples of the apostles are teaching completely contrary to the apostles. It's the complete opposite of what his teacher is supposed to have told him. And this is what all of this stuff is based on. So these traditions, no less than 10 years after John's gospel, epistles and revelation, and the Fiscus Judaicus tax and persecution relief, are the evidence of a parting of the ways beginning in the second century due to deception and affliction. If Jesus came to bring a new religion, that new religion didn't show up until the second century. Here's what Paul says about this new religion. In Acts 24, verse 14, and Paul is being put on trial here. But this I confess unto thee, that after the way which they call heresy, so worship I the God of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and in the prophets. So this new religion didn't show up essentially until the second century, when all of these people were essentially martyred. Christianity, therefore, as it is known today, did not begin with Jesus. It began with the separation from the faith and custom of the disciples of Yeshua in the first century by those who were the disciples of the Gentile church fathers in the second and beyond. That's when it became distinct from one another. That's when the separation came. But if you don't understand that, every time you open the Bible, you're going to see the Bible through these second century believers' eyes. That's deception. Here's another quote. But Sunday is the day on which we all hold our common assembly, because it is the first day on which God, having wrought a change in the darkness and matter, made the world. And Jesus Christ, our Savior, on the same day rose from the dead. For he was crucified on the day before that of Saturn, Saturday. And on the day after that of Saturn, which is the day of the sun. So now you have the church father called Justin Martyr in roughly 153 AD to 155 AD, pitching his doctrine essentially to pagan people. He's pitching the Christian religion to pagans now. Come and worship on the day of the sun. This is the day Jesus rose from the sepulchre. And so on. Having appeared to his apostles and disciples, he taught them these things, which we have submitted to you also for your consideration. It's funny because he apparently taught them these things, but lo and behold, we don't see that teaching in the Bible. We don't see that teaching in the Bible, and that's in the first apology, chapter 67. And we're going to be closing, but I'm just here making the distinction and giving you a timeline as to how we've come to this place, how the people have accepted the mark of the church and have abandoned the sign of Jehovah. Let him who contends that the Sabbath is still to be observed as a balm of salvation and circumcision on the eighth day teach us that for the time past righteous men kept the Sabbath or practiced circumcision and were thus rendered friends of God. For if circumcision purges a man, since God made Adam uncircumcised, why did he not circumcise him even after his sinning? If circumcision purges. Therefore, since God originated Adam uncircumcised and unobservant of the Sabbath, consequently his offspring also Abel, offering him sacrifices uncircumcised and unobservant of the Sabbath, was by him God commended. Noah also uncircumcised, yes, and unobservant of the Sabbath. God freed from the deluge. For Enoch too, most righteous man, uncircumcised and unobservant of the Sabbath. He translated from this world, who did not first taste death in order that, being a candidate of eternal life, he might show us that we also may, without the burden of the law of Moses, please God. And this is Tertullian, another church father in the 3rd century, roughly 203 AD, in an answer to the Jews. So the deception essentially is an attack on the faith which was once delivered to the saints, and the attack is aimed at the observance of the Sabbath and the customs, the traditions, or the statutes and judgments which are in the law. That's where the deception is. The distinction is then made because of this affliction between first century believers, which we find in the Bible, and these people who we don't ever see mentioned as disciples or followers, which come after, these Gentiles who have decided to believe in Jesus but don't want to live as them, the persecuted folk. And I think we're essentially closing up very, very soon. It has come to my ears that certain men of perverse spirit have sown among you some things that are wrong and opposed to the holy faith, so as to forbid any work being done on the Sabbath day. What else can I call these men but preachers of Antichrist? So this is supposedly Pope Gregory the Great. So now we come to a place where the Antichrist is being perceived as people who observe the law. Now that mindset is being taught because the Jews were the ones who crucified Yeshua. That's where it's coming from. And as a result of that, the people who keep the law of Jehovah, which is perceived to be Jewish, is called Judaizers. History tells you that those people were afflicted and persecuted throughout history, all throughout the centuries. They were removed from lands. They were killed, they were taxed, all kinds of stuff. You had the option of conversion, or sometimes you had the option of death. This is where it came from and where it spiraled into. Who, when he comes, will cause the Sabbath day as well as the Lord's day to be kept free from all work? So now the Antichrist now is giving you a two-day holiday in a week. He's giving you 2 days of rest. This is the Antichrist who is supposedly to come. He gives you the Sabbath off, and he gives you the day of the sun off, this horrible Antichrist. For because he, the Antichrist, pretends to die and rise again, he wishes the Lord's day to be held in reverence, and because he compels the people to Judaize, that he may bring back the outward rite of the law and subject the purity of the Jews to himself. He wishes the Sabbath to be observed. What this is telling us is that observance of the Sabbath by the few was being retained in the 6th century. That's what it's telling us. There are believers in Yeshua who, despite the affliction, are retaining the observance of the Sabbath in the 6th century. And that is why this man, Pope Gregory, the so-called great, is mad as hellfire. That's why he's writing this. Where are we? For this which is said by the prophets. Now he's twisting the scriptures. You shall bring in no burden through your gates on the Sabbath. Jeremiah 17:24. could be held to as long as it was lawful for the law to be observed according to the letter. But after that, the grace of Almighty God, our Lord Jesus Christ, has appeared, the commandments of the law, which were spoken figuratively, cannot be kept according to the letter. For if anyone says that this about the Sabbath is to be kept, he must needs say that carnal sacrifices are to be offered. He must needs say too that the commandment about the circumcision of the body is to be retained. But let him hear the Apostle Paul saying, in opposition to him, if you be circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. And that's Galatians 5:2. And that's the Registrum Epistolarum in 597 AD. So this individual, obviously, you know, he's not read the Bible. He doesn't understand about the sacrifices of animals, which was to be done by the priests in the tabernacle or the temple. He doesn't understand these things because he's obviously a Gentile who has never had it in his mind to be a follower of Yeshua, but he is a follower of his church fathers. We understand that the Bible teaches us that there was a church in the wilderness. We find that in the book of Acts, and we find that in the book of Hebrews. If there was ever going to be a people called church fathers, we have to go all the way back past Yeshua, all the way back to where the oracles were given. But we're not to call any man father, for we have one father, we have one master. And I'm done here. Yeshua defines deception as an intentional leading away from the truth. The word, during his ministry, the religious leaders led the people astray through their doctrine, causing many to not be able to receive him and his sign 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Yeshua warned his disciples about the impact of deception, which leads to the many who are deceived to persecute the few who hold the truth. After his ascension, the called out few continue to hold on to truth, the word, as evidenced in the scriptures. This is evidenced in the scriptures. However, after the start of the second century, once the apostles were martyred in the main, the increasingly Gentile church parted ways with that of Yeshua and apostles, provoked by the Fiscus Judaicus persecution and tax relief of Rome. There was an incentive for you not to act and be as Yeshua. There's an incentive to believe on him, but not be like him. Consequently, those who previously believed in Yeshua yet lived like a Jew, believed in Jesus and lived as a Roman, a pagan, which is why in all of these early church writings, there's so much talk about the day of the sun and other of the celestial bodies to appease, to draw in these people, to fill up the pews and so on and so forth. The first separation to be made between the first and second century church was that of the Sabbath. That was the beginning. According to Yeshua, persecution, which caused many to be offended, caused to sin, provides an illustration of future events where the few who keep the commands of Jehovah and have the faith of Yeshua are afflicted, worn down, caused to sin, inspired by the devil, the ruler of the many. The Sabbaths are a sign between you and Jehovah forever, that he has sanctified you, and that those who remember it are consequently, of being sanctified, are set apart from the wrath which is poured out on the children of disobedience. Heed therefore the sign of Jehovah and Yeshua, the Lord of the Sabbath, and cleanse yourself by the water of the word, of the mark of the church. So there's a real push now for getting back into the word. These things are not really debatable. These are pretty much facts. Amen? Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Exodus 20, verse 8. Amen. So that wraps up the mark of the church and sign of God. I've said it from the very beginning. This is going to be a series which really, I'm presuming, because we know the word and we know history, many of us are very familiar with. However, there are people I know for sure in my family who are not familiar with this stuff. There are people in your family who might not be familiar. So it's an equipping teaching. It's a teaching that can be passed on to others. And when it turns into a e-book and a book, it's certainly something you can drop. Not a Christmas present, but you can just put through the letterbox. And they'll be joyous to receive something. Is there any questions about the teaching today or the series that we've sort of undertaken? Can you come to the front and speak into the mic, please?
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Yeah, I just wanted to find out if you know what Christians think concerning the scriptures that talk about the, keeping the commandments in the New Testament writings, like in 1 John. Do you know how they see those scriptures? I actually haven't thought to ask anyone. I don't know if you've heard anyone talk about it.
Yeah.
How did they see those scriptures, you know?
Okay. It really depends on who you're talking to and what denomination they are part of. And that's what will determine what kind of answer you give them. The majority of the times, the answer will be different for different people. But the majority of the times when I've sort of asks those kind of questions, the response that I get is that John was for the Jews and Paul was a vessel unto the Gentile church. So what essentially happens, and there's a place where that comes from, is the New Testament then gets divided up into books we can read but not necessarily follow, and books which we read and follow. And that comes from an individual, again, in the second century, who was called a heretic called Marcion. And Marcion, as some of you have heard, was the person who made the separation of the Old Testament and the New Testament, established Paul as the chief apostle for the Gentiles, and essentially tried to create a canon which didn't include the other books except for the Gospels and Paul's writings. That in those days was called heresy. This is where it comes from. So based on who you're talking to, the most part from what I've heard is that's John and John is for the Jews. I'm of Paul. So Paul is the one saying, I've not been crucified for you. Why are you saying that some of you, I'm of Cephas, I'm of Peter, I'm of Apollos, and then I'm of Paul? I didn't die for you. You know, you didn't get baptized in my name. I'm glad I didn't actually baptize you, because then you would say that I did it in my name. So that's, I don't know what anyone else is. What have you heard?
Sin as the transgression of the law, And he, us and he say that that law is the law of Jesus.
Yeah.
So that he make a distinction between the law of the Father and the law of Jesus. So we should not broke the law of Jesus, but the law of the Father was done away.
Yeah.
So and in this debate, he keeps make that distinction: the law of the Spirit and the law of God. So, yeah. But they believe Jesus, God, and Father are the same.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. It really depends.
Yeah.
Who you're talking to and what they've been trained. To repeat once you hear that kind of thing. Yes.
I just wanted to add as well, what I used to hear in my old church, what they used to say was, oh, you know, when Yeshua was walking through the field on the Sabbath day, yeah, and the apostles picked the corn, they were criticized for that. So that is one of the reasons why we realize that actually Shabbat, every day is holy. It's not just about Shabbat. They used to use that as a yeah, defense against keeping the Shabbat.
And it all goes back to the same thing, this new doctrine which came after. Because if you have a mindset of the people at the time, they were dealing with religious people, and it wasn't a religion prescribed by the Almighty. They were dealing with people who had these laws which don't come from the Bible. You can challenge someone, find me in the Bible where we're commanded not to pluck grains of corn. You won't never find it. You'll be there your whole life. It's not there. But if you look into these additional texts, which are part of the laws of Judaism, this is where you'll find commandments about grains of corn, tying your shoelaces, a Sabbath day's walk, and carrying your mat, and all this kind of stuff. And Yeshua wasn't into it. And it was because of Yeshua dealing with that, that the people could not see him as Messiah. All they could hear was the doctrine they'd been given by the religious leaders who were teaching Judaism. He was flabbergasted to the degree, telling Nicodemus, you're a teacher of Israel, you don't know what I'm saying. What I'm teaching you is you should know this. You know, you should know this. And he didn't, because the people's eyes are focused on their religion. So it really, once you see where it comes from and you can pin it down in history, then you can just see a lot of it just is being made up as we go along, you know. Is there any other questions in the house before I look online? Okay, let me see what's here. So we got like a prayer request. Is there any prayer requests from anyone before we read from online? Yeah.
Hi, could I just ask for prayer? I've got an assignment to hand in on Monday. It's going well, but I just pray that, I ask for your prayers, that it all goes well.
Okay. When you've got deadlines or tests to do, that's when the fire prayer comes out. I remember when I was on my way to do my driving test, and it was my teacher training test. I was praying hardcore, and I passed on both of them first time, and it was like yeah, because you know there was some sort of miracle that took place in the booth when I had 2 minutes and I had 2 pages to do, and basically I was just pressing the multiple choice answer, but God guided my fingers, like, and I passed. Amen. Okay, let's see. Prayer request, praying for healing. Been traveling a great deal in a short period of time. Okay, so I'm going to pray for one of the families who's with us online, and then I'll pray for you. So let's join in prayer.
Yes.
What kind of prayer do you want, Aleph?
You have a blocked nose.
You have a blocked nose? You need the breath of the Almighty up that nostril, okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Mm.
Okay. Okay. Father, in Yeshua's name, Father, our prayer today was that the word was sown into good ground. So we are praying that the people who are watching and tuning in Brazil and watching at a later date, that whatever hindrances there may be, that you'll remove them so the seed of the word can be sown and it bears forth good fruit. We pray, Father, that every time that they tune in or watch a teaching which is righteous and which is holy, which causes them to think, that your Holy Spirit will prepare their hearts and minds to receive, that you will give them all wisdom and understanding so they can hear and obey your word. And we are praying for our Brazilian brothers and sisters who are here, who are speaking to others and being ambassadors for your kingdom here in House of Israel, London. We pray, Father, that you will anoint them all, that you will give them the ability to speak in love truth. To help, Father, remove the veil of confusion and the veil of deception away from the eyes of the people so they can see Yeshua as Messiah, whilst at the same time understanding that your word, which was established in the beginning, is life. We are praying, Father, that there be a revival of truth in that country, that people will be drawn to your word. Use the brothers and sisters which are here today in Yeshua's name. And Father, we are praying for Cassandra and her family. We know that times sickness can attack and come upon us, but we rebuke sickness in the name of Yeshua. We rebuke despair in the name of Yeshua. And we pray that the peace that surpasses all understanding will enter into that home and the situation that they are in. We know, Father, that this world can grind you down because that's what's written. But when we are weak, in our weakness, we know that you are our strength. You are strong. So, Father, we pray that the spirit that they now receive is not one of fear, not one of confusion, not one of despair, or of any kind of heaviness, but the spirit of power, love, and of a sound mind. Liberate them from any shackles the enemy or this world may try to place upon them. Cause them, Father, to walk freely and be still by the waters and those green pastures. In Yeshua's name. And we pray for Nicola at this time. We understand, Father, that there are requirements and tests and examinations. But, Father, we also know that your understanding, your wisdom, your word, your understanding goes beyond anything we could even begin to comprehend. And when we have your spirit, we have access to that knowledge and that peace that comes from knowing these things. So we pray that during the time of exams and preparation, that you will cause her to be like a sponge, ready to receive and then ready to pour out. May her mind be still, and may her have the ability to work according to what you have given her. In Yeshua's name, cause her to be a success so she can be a light unto other people who may be going through situations that she is going through. And we, Father, finally, we pray for Aleph. We pray and we bless him, Father, because we know that we are to bless the little ones, to bless the children. And we pray that your blessings will pour out upon him, that sickness or infirmity will no longer have a foothold or any place in his life. So we declare the freedom, the healing over him in Yeshua's name. We declare the nostrils to be opened in Yeshua's name. We declare any fungus or any, not fungus, but the green stuff in his body, the mucus, to dissipate, to cease from existing, so he can breathe freely once again. We pray just like what we see in the Bible when these young children were filled with your spirit from a young age, from their youth, that you will breathe the breath of life and healing into him in Yeshua's name. And we bless all of your people here today and all of your people watching online right now and those who will come and join us at a later date. We pray in Yeshua's name that by the word which was given today, that they will be equipped by it, that they will be challenged by it, and that they will be provoked to share the gospel of the kingdom another time with their families and with their friends. Father, open up doorways of opportunity for your will to be done through them. May they be established on your rock. May they be built on the rock, oaks of righteousness, the salt of the earth, a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. And I ask, finally, that you bless your people. In Yeshua's name, receive your blessing. May Jehovah bless you and keep you. May Jehovah cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Jehovah lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace in Yeshua's name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. So, I'm excited as to what was going to come next. I'm not entirely sure. I'm sure the Father will reveal that to me very, very soon. But yeah, that concludes our the mark of the church and the sign of God. Everyone, at this point, you are free. You are dismissed if you want to go and fellowship and want to eat and speak. But I'm ready if anyone has any comments or testimonies that they would like to share. And just before that, here it is, the book. The book is here. Are you justified? We put it into a book. It's been a work in progress. All I can say is for everyone who supported the stuff that we do here, thank you for supporting with your tithes, offerings, for coming here. I know that I say, and I would come here and minister to the camera and to my son behind the camera, but it's always good to know that there is a people here who come and who fellowship and hear the word every single week. So the book is here. This is something, it's not expensive, and on Amazon or on the website, and it's even for free if you want to download it in ebook version. So use it, give it to your friends, give it to your families, get the word out there and give it a positive review so it can go up the charts. So again, is there any comments or questions or testimonies before we close, we conclude?
Can I just ask a quick question?
Yes.
Right.
I'm a little bit lost as to, you know, when the Jewish month starts and ends. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if there'd be any teaching on like new moons and things so that we know, you know, about the months.
Yeah.
And also, is there like, do Hebrew roots do a calendar? I'd really like a calendar to, you know, from Easter. Oh, from, sorry, not from Easter. From Passover, April, okay. You know.
Well, we've got a teaching which is called Are You Wasting God's Time? Which is online. If you look on YouTube. Now that teaching, which we've done on YouTube, talks about the Sabbath. It talks about the months, and it also talks about the feasts. I'm not entirely sure which of the three speaks specifically about the beginning of the months, but it might be the second one. But just check them all out, and it will give you the teaching of about when the months start. But the first thing, once you just start, we need to, when we look at the word month in the Bible, the Hebrew means the new moon, and that's just to start you off. So once you watch that teaching, it will be expanded for you. And in terms of the months, if there's one to buy at this point, there are many out there, and what I choose to do is to witness and to look at what people are doing, knowing the teaching that I have. So what I'm sort of trying to express is that I don't necessarily hold or promote a physical calendar for the purpose that when you watch the teaching, you'll be able to see that these physical calendars can be wrong, especially if they're Jewish. Yeah. If the Bible says the month starts and it's the month is a new moon, then that tells us we need to wait for the new moon for the month to start. What that tells us is that Jewish calendars, which are projecting months in years to come, they're doing it based on an algorithm which isn't necessarily biblical. But once you go through the teaching, it's layered very clearly, you'll understand what I essentially mean by that. So it's all there on YouTube for you. And if you've got any other questions about it, then please feel free to ask. So just some comments. Great teaching, brother. Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. Ivan and PJ, very good teaching. Thank you from Henk. Bless you for that. Cher Campbell, Sharon just says, yes, with an exclamation mark. I'm presuming that's a good thing to say yes, but yeah, it sounds awesome. Someone is saying not playing any ideas. I've not been from Matthew. I'm assuming that's been dealt with, but we've not had any technical issues on our side, and it looks like someone has tried to help you out with that. Terry, a very relative and righteous word for today. Shabbat Shalom. Okay, so it looks like we are all done. Don't forget to support the ministry with your tithes, offerings, and help us get the gospel of the kingdom out. We got one more. Okay, would you want to come? It can't reach you, I'm afraid. Well, I'm not sure, actually. I don't think it can. Do you want to just pull that chair? Just pull that chair.
Yeah, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Just a comment and something that was went over that I'd like to just sort of emphasize a little bit. I was just reflecting on when, you know, Yeshua was actually speaking to the scribes and the Pharisees, and in it he was actually saying, this is Matthew 23, reading from verse 13, it says, but woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you shut off the kingdom of heaven from people, For you do not enter in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you devour widows' houses, and for pretense you make long prayers. And there's a whole area where he's actually condemning those who, block others from entering into the kingdom of heaven because they've got their own agenda. And I think this too much is actually what is actually going on. And in another part, he says that, verse 31, so you testify against yourselves that you are sons of those who murdered the prophets. Fill up then the measure of the guilt of your fathers. You serpents, you brood of vipers, how will you escape the sentence of hell? Therefore, behold, I am sending you prophets and wise men and scribes. So here Yeshua is actually saying he is sending, right? Prophets, wise men, and scribes. Some of them you will kill and crucify. And we know that this is talking about the apostles and the true believers, the chosen, called out. Some of them you will kill and crucify, and some of them you will scourge in your synagogues and persecute them from city to city, so that upon you may fall the guilt of all the righteous blood shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Truly I say to you all, these things will come upon this generation. And then Matthew 24, where you touched on verse 4, saying, see to it that no one misleads you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ. And we know that the title of the Pope is the Vicarius, which means Vicar of Christ. In other words, he's in the stead of Christ. And this is what it actually means. And so therefore, he's saying, well, if you want any intercession, you got to come to me. Right? So, saying, I am the Christ, and will mislead many, you will be hearing of wars and rumors of, and then it goes into that further. Verse 7 says, for nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and in various places there will be famines and earthquakes. Now I'm just going to quickly go to Revelation, which we actually looked at. Revelation 12. Verse 17, says, so the dragon was enraged with the woman. I went to make war with her and the rest of her children. And we know, as was touched upon, that we know those who are the children of Jehovah, right? Those that are actually keeping his commandments and doing his will. And we know, when you look at this, it's quite interesting that it's there before our eyes, and many times we actually don't see it. It takes the Spirit of the living God to actually reveal. Through what we heard today, the historical data of what actually took place, and that is an area that I'm always actually touching on, and I'm glad Marcus went into depth even more with it. Because it's very important to know these things, to know when the church went into apostasy. And this is where many refuse to look into or even to understand or even want to understand because they're comfortable where they are. But comfortable is not going to cut it, right? Because when Yeshua returns and as he prophesied, saying, right, many will say that, didn't I heal in your name? Didn't I preach and do great works in your name? He's talking to those who call themselves Christians and believers in him. And he's going to say to them, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, or as correctly translated, lawlessness. I know you not. He's literally going to say, I don't know you. And you've been preaching, you've been calling on my name day after day, doing great works. Great works. And yet he's going to say he doesn't know them. So he goes on to say that who make war with the rest of her children, who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Yeshua. So here is plain, those who keep the commandments of God. So as we know that there are some who say that, oh, only you have to keep the commandments of Jesus. Keep the commandments of Jesus. Okay, well, he always says it is written. And that is what he kept. And as John says, the same John that wrote this revelation, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word was manifest. So he was there in the beginning. He is the Word that was spoken, the Word that was given, the law. The law of God is the Word of God, and is the mind of God, God that is given to us. So quickly, and the last bit, I just want to touch on Revelation again, 20, verse 4, which says, then I saw thrones, and they that sat on them, and judgment was given to them, and I saw the souls of those that had been beheaded because of the testimony of Yeshua and because of the word of God. And I actually looked into this. It talks about the testimony of Yeshua and the word of God. And that word is actually what they use, actually the logos. And I just looked into it more, and it's actually, it goes to explain it more. It talks about the word uttered embodies a conception or idea. Then it goes on to say what someone has said, a word, the sayings of God. Right. Then it goes further down and says, of the moral precepts given by God. And then it goes on to say, Old Testament prophecy given by the prophets. So he's actually going and he's explaining what this actually means. So when he talks about the saints that were souls that were beheaded, right, because of their testimony of Jesus, right, and of the word of God. That's what he's talking about. What many teach that, you know, it's done away with. This is actually it. So, you know, I'm just encouraging the saints, look into it more for yourself. Yeah. Study it and understand it for yourself. Because the majority will not know it, will not want to know it, and will not accept it. Because they are not desirous to go further in and allow the Spirit of truth to lead them. And you will find that, unfortunately, we will be few in number, because only few will want to accept the true word of Jehovah.
Can I just add something to what you're saying? I just want to add something really briefly. I think, though, I get what you're saying, and it's absolutely correct, but I also think we need to be mindful. Yeshua discusses iniquity, doing things that you knowingly know are wrong, and... So there's a difference between someone getting the not getting the revelation yet, or someone who's sincerely seeking the Lord but happens to be in a church and hasn't got the revelation yet. There's a difference between that and someone knowing the law and deliberately not doing it.
We do know that, and we've spoken of that in length. But what you have to understand is this, right? I just read in Matthew 24, you see, and in other scriptures you have the part where the young man comes to him saying, you know, what can I do to inherit the kingdom? Yeah. There's a part where, you know, the Almighty is there, Yeshua is teaching, he's giving the true word of Jehovah, and he's got grace and mercy to show others, right? But they... further on in 24 and coming to the end of his ministry now, he's ramping it up. He's stepping it up now, right? And he's even more so condemning the leadership, right? And it's not only a matter of just the leadership, right? It is a matter of when those who don't know any better, you pray for them. But the time is going to come, and it's now that the true knowledge is going out. They have to make a choice, and they cannot come before the Almighty with any excuses. We cannot come before him with any excuses, because is letting the truth, I mean, look at it this way now. It's, you know, if the truth is 5,000 miles away, Jehovah has given man the ability and knowledge to create the internet, cameras, the TV, these things. So the gospel of the truth is going all over the world. And what is happening as well is that there are others who are proclaiming this truth that we have heard today and we are proclaiming today. And do you know what some of the Christian stations do?
Yeah.
They have, when they hear this truth going out, right, they turn around and try to cut them off and close them down. And this is what those individuals are, they're going to get their condemnation. And this is why I read in Matthew 23, when Yeshua said, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees. There are many scribes and Pharisees today.
Yeah.
I just have a little testimony about an experience I had with someone who I was sharing about the Sabbath and keeping the Sabbath. And this individual, you know, is more secular than anything. I wouldn't say that she's actually sort of like a hardcore Christian or anything like that, but she claims to believe. And the question was asked about the Sabbath, because they're curious as to why I keep the Sabbath, and I began to explain. And I went into a little bit about the history of what we dealt with today. And slowly, you can begin to see, like, this heaviness began to convict her, and she couldn't take the truth of it. She was shook to the point where she was telling me to just keep quiet. I don't want to hear anymore. She was closing her ears. She said, I don't want to hear. Stop, stop, stop. I don't want to hear. And when you see something like that happen to someone, you can understand that there are just some people who just can't be saved, you know, in that way. You know, they just can't hear. You know, Noah preached, you know, right up until the destruction, the people were like, you know, we don't want to hear what you have to say, you know. And so really what I'm saying is that there are just some people who just can't. I mean, the sister was saying, you know, they can't receive revelation. There's some who believe, but they can't see. But there's also some who claim to believe, but they don't want to receive the truth. Really, they want their traditions. They want their, you know, the stuff that they were fed, you know. It was quite tragic to see, and a little bit scary to see someone actually closing their ears, telling me to stop, almost like they're trying to hide. You know, I know, like the light was so bright.
It was like
the scar print for darkness. Put me back under my covers and show me the darkness. It was much more comfortable there, you know.
Yeah.
So
it's like, it's pretty much what Yeshua dealt with in his day, and he just went back to what it says in Isaiah, that you have eyes to see and you do not see, and ears to hear but you do not hear, because if you did hear and see, then your heart would have to be converted. So it happens in Yeshua's day, and what that tells us is that when we're speaking to people, in our minds, it's very simple, because what Father has done is given us revelation by His Spirit. He's dropped that, He's removed the veil, and we've received that revelation. But for other people, it's not there yet. So no matter how simply we put it, some people will just not receive it. So it's sort of like a situation where you can keep continuing to sow seed, hoping that one day it will go into the ground and bear full fruit, or you can go to another field and see if that field bears forth fruit. And it's a judgment call. I know what the Bible says: if they don't receive what you're saying, shake the dust. But I can't shake the dust on, like, my mum, because she's gonna call me. And I'm not saying my mum is this or that or the other, it's just an example. But if I'm in relationship with someone and I can't shake the dust, I can know who the Bible says my brothers are, but I still have to live in this world. So while I'm in this world, I'm going to sow seed and hope. And I've seen it happen that at some point in time, at a time when Father has designated it, it will be received and it will bear forth fruit.
I think the shock of what I was saying to this individual, it was more the realization that all this time she's been under a deception, she's been told the wrong thing. And I think that was a hard part of it. Because she said, you need to tell me all this, you know, that all this time it's been, I've been, you know, been told wrong. You know what I mean? I'm like,
yeah. That's it.
And they said, well, what about you? You also was there. I said, yeah, but now I can see that it was wrong. But the transition for some is just too hard. It's just it's too much.
Yeah. But we've got the tools. We've got the word. We've got the teachings. We've got the tools. And it's the prayer that I had from the very beginning that we'll cover this ground and we'll have equipment to use when we're approaching certain people to give us the best opportunity to break through that stony ground and try and get the seed into the heart. I believe that is us done for today. Unless there's anything else, we are going to close. Hallelujah. Well, enjoy the fellowship. I'm hoping those online will join us next week. Tell your friends and family about what we're doing here. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom.